just what are the deceptions that occur during the Great Tribulation by which many will be deceived? This is part 16 of the Olivet Discourse series. We've been working on a series of YouTube videos about the Olivet Discourse. This was a discourse when Jesus was on the Mount of Olives during the Passion Week. He spoke it to his disciples. The prophecy had to do with the destruction of the temple in Jerusalem. Not one stone would be left upon another. The disciples, of course, had two questions. When will these temples buildings be destroyed? And secondly, what is the sign of the end of the world and the second coming? So the whole Olivet Discourse in Matthew, Mark, and Luke, it had all together to do with which is known as the Great Tribulation. It's the time period of intense tribulation on the church prior to the second coming of Christ, and then also the last day and the second coming of Jesus Christ. Please consider subscribing to this channel. There's a little red button in the bottom right-hand corner. Just a quick review of the order of events that occur in prophecy. We've been in the church age for some 2,000 years. Right at the end of the church ages appeared a time called the apostasy, which I believe we're in now because there's a great falling away. Then comes the Great Tribulation. It's that little season of time where there's great deception, and that's what we're going to be looking at in this video. It involves the loosing of Satan. The Satan powers the Antichrist. There's false Christ. There's abomination of desolation. Babylon's the church. Then comes the last day, the second coming of Jesus Christ, the resurrection of the dead for salvation or judgment, which ushers in the eternity and the new heavens and the new earth. Okay, here are some key passages in the Olivet Discourse that talk about deception. Take heed that no man deceive you. There's deceivers, for many shall come in my name, saying, I am Christ, and shall deceive many. And we'll look at the false Christ in another video that's coming up. Matthew 24:11, many false prophets shall arise and deceive many. Matthew 24:23-26, people say, lo, here is the Christ. Don't believe them, for there shall arise false Christ and false prophets. They'll show great signs and wonders, insomuch that if it were possible, they would deceive the very elect, God's people, the very elect. Behold, I have told you before, wherefore if they say, behold, he is in the desert, go not forth. He's in a secret chambers, believe it or not. Because he comes as a flash of lightning, and everybody will see him, every eye will see him. But the purpose of this video is to look at deception that occurs in the Olivet Discourse. We're going to begin this study by understanding what that word deception means in the Greek language. Okay, so when we see the deception in the Olivet Discourse, it happens over and over and over. Take heed that no man deceive you. Because there's going to be people that will deceive many. They'll try to deceive the very elect, God's people that have the Holy Spirit. Now that Greek word deceive is the Greek word plano, which literally means to be strayed or wandered away or stray. It's from the Greek word planos, of which we get the word planet from. When we look at the planets in the sky, they're called planets, which is derived from the Greek, because they wander in the sky compared to the stars that are fixed. We also see Mark 13:22, that word seduce, it's again the same word. Seduce, if it was possible, even the very elect. That Greek word is apoplano, which literally means to off stray, to stray away. And again, it's from that Greek word planos. So deception has to do with, it's straying away from the truth. Deception can be very subtle. It's like moving slightly away, but it's not true. It's deception. We see the wandering stars, the false teachers in the book of Jude, and we've done a study on the book of Jude, and I'll tag that video we've done on this slide. They were called wandering stars. It's the Greek word planets, from the Greek word planos again, to me, to stray, to deceive, to be an error. It's, again, the English word planet is derived from that same Greek word, but the false teachers of Jude are subtle. They're symbolized as deceiving stars because they sound Christian and they say Christian type of things. And the stars, by the way, literally, stars represent messengers. They're false messengers. They're messengers with error, but they're close to the truth, but they are not the truth. So the meaning of deception, it's really any behavior. Now, it can be in word or in deed. It's what we do. We can deceive people in what we do, where we go, how we say things. It's anything that would cause people to stray from the truth. It could be false teaching. It could be used in the scripture out of context, which happens all the time. Lying signs and wonders, that's more of a deed, but still they're deceptive because they sound like they look like they're from God, but they're not. They're from Satan. Speaking in vague type of ways, flattering people, hypocritical actions, showing concern and love when it's just for their advantage. It might be for financial advantage. So deception is a subtlety to it that leads people away from the truth. Okay, now when we look at the Old Testament, we see nice verses that help us. He that speaks truth shows forth righteousness, but a false witness deceit. Deceit is not true. It's the opposite of truth. Even though it can look like the truth, it's not the truth. Proverbs 14, a true witness delivers souls. That's talking about the gospel and salvation. But a deceitful witness speaketh lies. It's a lie. It's close to the truth. It's deceptively looks like the truth, but it's a lie. Jeremiah 9, they will deceive everyone his neighbor and will not speak the truth. Again, deception is lying and it's not the truth. Similarly, in the New Testament, we see the same comparison with truth. 2 Corinthians 4:2, but have renounced the hidden things of dishonesty. They can be hidden, not walking in craftiness, tricking people, nor handling the word of God deceitfully, using the Bible, but teaching it so it's altering the truth. That happens all the time. Most of the teaching you hear in churches is very deceitful and deceptive. It's not really the true gospel. It's not real true prophecy, but by manifestation of the truth. We see deceit used in comparison with truth. Deceit is not truth. 2 Corinthians 6:8, as deceivers yet true. Also 2 Thessalonians 2:10, this is talking about the time of the Great Tribulation, the time when the man of sin is, the Antichrist is out, with all deceivableness of unrighteousness in them that perish. Because they receive not the love of the truth. To love the truth means to diligently study the Bible. Study to show yourself well approved. A workman that need not be ashamed. Because the Bible is truth. 1 John 1:8. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. We can see how we can fool ourselves very easily by straying away from truth. Okay, now we want to look at the origin of deception. Where did deception come from? What's the purpose of deception? The origin of deception is none other than Satan himself, the devil, the serpent, the dragon, all the same name for Satan. He was a deceiver from the beginning. He was that cherub that covered until iniquity was found in him because he's deceptive. He's not of the truth. We see in Genesis 3, the serpent was more subtle than any beast of the field which the Lord God had made. He said to the woman, yea, has God said, you shall not eat of every tree of the garden? He was subtle. He went there to fool Eve and deceive her. That word subtle there, it's the Hebrew word arum, which means to be cunning or crafty. And this is this idea about Satan deceiving Eve goes to 2 Corinthians 11, verse 3. I fear as a serpent beguiled Eve, through his subtlety, so your mind should be corrupted from the simplicity that is in Christ. That word simplicity literally means singleness. It means there's no contradictions. You can tell deception, but somebody that deceives, well, it's contradicting what God has said. And Satan attacked Eve by questioning what God said. And that's how deception occurs. It's not denying God, but it's deceiving. It's altering the truth. It's making one stray away, being like a planet that's wandering around. We see that the devil has no truth. John 8, Jesus condemns the Pharisees. You of your father, the devil. The lust of your father ye will do. The devil had lust. He had lust for adoration. He wanted to be honored and worshipped. He was jealous of God. He was a murderer from the beginning and abode not in the truth, because there's no truth in him. Everything he does is deception. There's many people today that their whole life is all about deception and fooling people. A lot of politicians and many other people in industry and all over are deceiving people. When he speaks a lie, he speaks of his own, for he is a liar and the father of it. The deception, the lies, the attack on truth started right with Satan. The great dragon was cast out, that old serpent called the devil and Satan, which deceives the whole world. That's what he was all about, is to subtly deceive. Let's now turn to the deception that occurred during the church age. Now, the deception of Satan, when we come to the church age, when we come to the cross, that deception was somewhat curtailed. It was rendered idle, so the gospel could go forth. Now, that doesn't mean there's not still deception, but we read in Hebrews chapter 2 that through death, Jesus Christ, the death of Christ on the cross, he might destroy him that had the power of death, that is the devil. There was an impact at the cross. There was a great titanic battle that occurred on the cross. And that word destroy is not to obliterate the Satan, because he still exists. He was actually cast out of heaven. He was sent to the earth. But we see that that word destroy is kataargio, which literally means it's to send down and be idle. He was bound. And we read that in Revelation 20. He laid hold of the dragon, this is at the cross, that old serpent, devil, Satan, and bound him for 1,000 years. The millennium is not a literal 1,000 years. It's a symbolic number. The millennium is really the church age, and there's many people that deceive. That's part of false prophecy. Many people believe it. Many people don't, of course, but many people believe in this thing called the millennium, and it's not true. And we tag videos that we've done on this presentation here, but the devil was bound for 1,000 years. Why? So he should deceive the nations. The nations, the Greek word ethnos, it points to the Gentiles no more, because the Gentiles didn't have the word of God in the Old Testament. They were completely deceived and under the sway of Satan. But he was bound at the cross, so he deceives the nations no more till the 1,000 years should be fulfilled. And after that, he may be loosed a little season. That little season, as we're going to get to, is the Great Tribulation, when the Antichrist is powered by Satan again. Satan's loosed and he's allowed to deceive. Now, so we see that Satan was bound at the cross so he would not deceive. Now we're going to look that resulted in a wonderful thing. The gospel exploded into the world. It virtually exploded. The gospel was veiled. It was the Old Testament was the gospel, but it was in a veiled manner, if you will. But when Satan was bound to the cross, the New Testament was written by the apostles by the inspiration of the Holy Spirit. And we see that the gospel exploded. Note Romans 16:26. Now is made manifest by the scriptures of the prophets, made known to all nations for the obedience of the faith. It's going out to the world. It's amazing what happened. Acts 1:8, you shall be witnesses unto me both in Jerusalem and all Judea, Samaria, unto the uttermost parts of the earth. And that's exactly what happened. The gospel, the Bible went out to the whole ends of the earth. Even today, we see the results of that. Over 1.5 billion people think they're a Christian. Of course, they're not all Christians, but the gospel exploded. Acts 2, the same day that were added unto them were about 3,000 souls. There was very relatively few in the upper room when the Holy Spirit was given, but immediately the gospel went forth. 3,000 souls. Acts 4:4, many of them which heard the word believed, and the number of men was about 5,000. That's just the men. What about the women and other children? The gospel exploded. we see that the nations receive the gospel. Again, remember Revelation 23. Satan was bound at the cross, so he deceives the nations no more. This, and we see Acts 28, 28. The salvation of God is sent unto the Gentiles, that they will hear it. Satan is bound. The gospel is exploding. To whom God would make known what is the riches of glory of this mystery among the Gentiles, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory. Beautiful scripture. 1 Timothy 3, God was manifest in the flesh, justified in the spirit, seen of angels, preached unto the Gentiles, believed on in the world, and received up into glory. The gospel explodes. But, deception still exists. Satan is bound. He was cast into the abyss. He was sent down to the earth. He roams the earth. Satan walks around as a devouring lion, seeking people to devour. But his power is very limited. Satan and his angels go about deceiving, and there's plenty of his demons that go about deceiving. He's the prince of the power of the air. He still controls the kingdoms of this world. The true Christians are a minority, but the gospel did explode, and it went to the Gentiles. He was bound in that manner, and he could not deceive because the Bible is out there. Satan is still the god of this world, and he still walks about, but he doesn't have that position any longer. He's no longer in heaven. He walks about on this earth with limited ability and limited, because he's bound. So there's still deception during the church age. Satan has been rendered idle so the gospel can go to the Gentiles, to God's elect people, so they will be saved. But we see examples here of deception, 2 Timothy 3, evil men and seducers shall wax worse and worse, deceiving and being deceived. Well, evil men, unsaved people, are under the sway of their father, Satan. You're either a child of God or a child of Satan. We see 1 John 2:26 that a lot of the Bible is trying, in the New Testament, the apostles were battling with deception. These things I've written unto you concerning them that seduce, and that word seduce there, it's that Greek word planio again, that deceive you. Because there was people deceiving all through the church age. But again, the gospel was exploding. Balaam is a great example of a false prophet gone astray. That word gone astray, again, it's that plano word. It's to be deceived. He went astray. He deceived, following the way of Balaam. The false teachers talked about in 2 Peter 2, they went after the way of Balaam. They were deceived. And the way of Balaam was about making money, using religion for money. He was a prophet for hire, essentially. He taught Balak how to have Israel fail by committing idolatry and worshiping other gods. He was a false prophet. The church in Thyatira features another one, the false prophetess Jezebel. And again, this is symbolic language pointing to the fact that people in the church, they teach and seduce, and that word seduce there again is deceive, my servants to commit fornication, to eat things sacrificed to idols, and that spiritual fornication, and to worship other gods and idols by eating things sacrificed to idols. That's a symbolic way of talking about idolatry. So deception is still active in the church age. Okay, but now we need to turn to the deception in the Great Tribulation. Because Satan is bound, the gospel explodes into the world, there's still deception going on, but it's on a limited basis. The people have the word of God, but in the Great Tribulation, he's now loosed from his prison. He's given that power again. He's allowed to deceive the nations. The Olivet Discourse has several references to deception. It talks about false Christ. It talks about which false Christ, it means it's someone that claims to be an anointed one, because Christ means anointed one. There's false prophets. There's all type of things that we're warned about. People saying the time is near, which we're hearing that already today, that imminent return of Christ. He's in the desert, secret places. It's a secret rapture. All that's false prophecy. Great signs and wonders. Now, we're going to look at these individually in the Olivet Discourse in individual videos. But for now, for the time that we have left, we want to look at other passages in the New Testament that talk about deception to get the full impact of how the Great Tribulation, why it's such a very deceptive time, and if Satan is loose from his prison, he goes about deceiving people in the church. Okay, first we see the Antichrist. The Antichrist, and we've done a whole series on the Antichrist. Please look at the description section of this video. We have many links in there. But we have a whole series, a multi-video series on Antichrist. Very important information. And the Antichrist arises in the Great Tribulation. He's called the man of sin in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. Even him, who's coming as after the working of Satan. Remember, Satan is loose from his prison during the Great Tribulation. He empowers the Antichrist with all power and signs and lying wonders. There's those lying signs and wonders again. Signs and wonders are not today. They're lying signs and wonders. They ceased when the Bible was completed. And with all deceivableness of unrighteousness in them that perish. Again, deception. The Antichrist comes to deceive. In the Old Testament, we see examples of this Antichrist with deception. The Antichrist has all together to do with the abomination of desolation. It's the kingdom of Satan, which brings worldliness into the church. And we've already seen that starting today. But during the Great Tribulation, that's going to be what the churches are completely. The King of the North is a type of the Antichrist in Daniel 11. He shall take away the daily sacrifice, that daily sacrifice of being in the Word of God, praying and serving others. But instead, they place the abomination that makes desolate, that worldliness, that love of pleasure, that love of idolatry. And this Antichrist, the King of the North, will corrupt by flatteries. Even today, we see flattery, the politicians that flatter the people and try to fool them into following them. Many shall cleave to them with flatteries. The little horn, there's a little horn of Daniel 7, a little horn of Daniel 8. They're both types of the Antichrist. The one in Daniel 8, he's against the daily sacrifice by reason of transgression. Cast down truth. There's that deception again. Through his policy, he shall cause craft or deceit to prosper in his hand. We already see people that fit the bill today, very deceptive people. He shall magnify himself in his heart, and by peace he shall destroy many. The Antichrist deceiving. Also, we have, in the book of Revelation, we have the Satanic Trinity, which we've done videos on. We've done a whole study in the book of Revelation. You have Satan, also known as the dragon. You have the beast, which is the Antichrist. And you have the false prophet, the beast with two horns, which is a symbolic representation of the church during the Great Tribulation. The two horns spoke as a lamb. They use the Bible, but they have horns like a lamb, but they speak like a dragon because it's false, deceptive. It's the false Christian church with two strong focal points of evil witness. The leadership of the church, and two is the number of witness. The lamb looks like a Christian, but it's false. The horns are strength. Politics in the church speaks like a dragon. The dragon, Satan, it's all about deception and lies, with false gospels and false prophecy. And this beast with the two horns, also known as the false prophet in the book of Revelation, causes people to worship the beast or the Antichrist. This false prophet deceives with great signs and fire falls from heaven. Those are parallel passages to what we're going to study in the Olivet Discourse. He makes an image of the beast so that he gives breath to that image so it can speak. And again, we've done studies on this in our Book of Revelation study. The image of the beast is none other than the false Christian church and parachurches. And it can speak. It peddles satanic doctrines and false teaching and false gospels and signs and wonders. Anyone that does not worship the image of the beast, which is the church, is killed. Or rather, killed means to be silenced. God's people are silenced in the church. All who buy and sell must receive the mark or name. Anyone that wants to participate in the merchandising of religion has to be involved with the beast. The true God's people are not allowed to do that in the church anymore. That's what the Great Tribulation is all about. Please take a look at our Revelation series that goes into all this in much more detail. Finally, Babylon. Babylon in the book of Revelation is another representation of the false Christian church. and the parachurches. There's more parachurches now than there are churches, but it's all about the sorcery of deception. And all of the things that's talked about in Babylon all point to false teaching. It points to the fact that there's lying, there's all type of wicked things that go on. And again, we have this in our Revelation series. Just a quick summary of this video about deception. Deception is a huge feature of the Great Tribulation. Some people think the Great Tribulation is all about things that happen in this world. The Great Tribulation is actually on God's people. It's on the church. And it's all about deception because Satan has been released for that little season. He was bound at the cross. The millennium is the church age. But after that, you have a little season where Satan is released, the rise of the Antichrist, and they go to deceive the world again. It's the nations. The church is mostly made up of the nations, the Gentiles, and that's where they go back to the churches to deceive. And they do that with the abomination of desolation. It's the kingdom of Satan in the church. Most of the people in the church are unsaved now. They're in there for pleasure and politics and all type of idolatry. It's the abomination of desolation. The Olivet Discourse talks about the false Christ, the false prophets, the great signs and wonders that all accompany this deception. We're going to look at that in upcoming videos. Please consider subscribing to this channel, and thank you very much for watching this video.